I may have made a mistake. Ken, do I need to wait or can I speak? Thumbs up and Ken. Fantastic. Well, welcome to Rainier Valley Church. I'd like to invite you, if you're able, to stand with me before we stay the same. Let me pray for us before we get started. Lord Jesus, thank you. God, I pray that you be with us. You would open our hearts and our minds to the word. Things that we need to relearn, prepare us. There's lots of stuff going on. And right now, I just ask your presence to be with us. And we just want to praise and give you glory. And thank you. Amen. Ourselves, we just need Jesus. Let's continue worshiping.
No.
work, Jesus. Thank you so much. All right, I forgot. Ben and Sarah. Where's Ben and Sarah?
Yeah,
Ben and
yeah,
Sarah,
yeah.
Raise their hands. In a moment, I'm going to ask everyone to please take some time to meet and greet with one another. And for all you kiddos, head over to Ben and Sarah.
Yeah, meet in the hallway. Yeah.
Meet in the hallway. All right. Take some time to talk to one another.
Yeah, oh yeah.
In the back, and then you can also grab a Bible. We have a Pray in the Bible book that's for free, and then we also have our Bible reading plan that we've been going through as well, so you can feel free to pick those up. A couple more announcements as we get started this evening. The first is we want you to be sure to save the date for our upcoming women's getaway. It's going to be on April 28th through 30th. Very cute little save the date. Bags with seeds in them that you can pick up on the table back there as well. If you have more questions, feel free to talk with me or our deaconess or women's ministry leader, Shelly, will be here for the potluck dinner just after the service. You can talk there as well. The next thing is that there is a women's social night coming up this Thursday. So to get this correct, for those of you ladies who go to the Wednesday night Bible study, this Wednesday, that's canceled, and kind of everything is encouraging the ladies to come to this hangout social night on Thursday. It's going to be at Shelly's house, and so if you're interested and you'd like to connect with other ladies, great time for sisterhood, for good food and fellowship, let me know, or Shelly, who will be at dinner tonight, and she can get you the directions, all right? We really want our ladies to know one another, to be known, to be loved, to be cared for. And so this is a great opportunity for your lady. Hope that you make a point, if you're able, to be there this coming Thursday. Next up, we have our online prayer meeting, and we have moved it from Monday to Tuesday. And I just want to actually invite up our leader of prayer, Patty. Give her a hand, everyone. If you could, why would we encourage people to join us for prayer on Tuesdays?
Absolutely. First of all, I am so glad to be in the house of God tonight.
Amen.
It feels so good to worship with you. I've been absent a few weeks, and it just feels so good to be with the body. You know what else is good? Praying together. Let me tell you a little bit. I pulled up a little scripture, and I have to use my phone. From Isaiah 56:7. These I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings, their sacrifices will all be accepted on my altar. For my house shall be called a house of prayer for all people. I just love that. And we have been blessed to be praying year after together. It was Monday a lot, or for a long time. Now we've moved into Tuesday, and we're reaping some benefits of that. We see it's good to be in church on Sunday, and then a little rest. We just thought it was better on Tuesday, and it's working out quite well. If you have any questions, please see me or the pastor, or go on Slack, where we'll have the link. late to the Zoom meeting. We meet by Zoom from 7 to 8. We go over a psalm, and then we begin praying over items that come up and whatever the Holy Spirit has put in on our hearts to pray about. It is such a blessing and encouraging to be brought together, brothers and sisters, believers, to encourage one another, be with one another, speak of those things, and pray together. It is just so good. I can't tell you how good it is. I don't know how else to encourage you, but do try it. That's my encouragement, because it is a blessing to get together.
Well, and Patty, I was in a pastoral cohort, a group of pastors that get together. One of the things they highlighted was they said, churches should be marked by prayer as showing our dependence on God.
Yes.
One of the things that they challenged me to personally was they said, you should pray as much as you do announcements. And so, would you be willing to lead, in particular, a couple of folks in our church just brought this up as we were praying before the service that the earthquakes that just happened in Turkey. Lots of folks impacted by that. Would you be willing to lead us all in a prayer? For I know Christian brothers and sisters who are responding and have been impacted as well. Would you be willing to pray for the situation and lead us all?
Yes, absolutely. Most precious Heavenly Father, it is good to be in your house tonight. It's encouraging, it's life-giving, and I am honored to stand here and on behalf of all of everyone here, anyone online and such, God, to bring to you, Lord, our adoration, our needs, our anything and everything. As we turn on the news, whether it's television or radio or even discussions with one another, we are, Lord, overwhelmed with the earthquakes and the things that are going on. But Father, this I know, because I know, it requires someone as great as you, someone who is more than able to hurt and bring relief, bring the needed things, God. I do pray for anyone around the world where we can do something, whatever our part is, that we would be moved by your Holy Spirit to reach and do our part, God. I thank you so much for the Holy Spirit that you have left with us to help us and empower us to move forward. God, do bless those every single story we hear and those we don't. God, we are such a needy person, needy people. So God, we just trust as we wait and respond. Thank you for this opportunity. I thank you for tonight's word. God, that it would not return void, that it would go out and our hearts would be faithful. Thank you for our pastor and his with him as he brings forth the word. Bless him as the blessings pour to the congregation. Thank you, Father God, for this opportunity to gather in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Give that a hand. Jump into it tonight. If you have a Bible with you, and I hope you do, go ahead and open it to the Song of Solomon. Song of Solomon should be in the middle of your Bible. If you don't have a Bible, there's Bible apps on your phone. There are Bibles, free physical Bibles in the back. You can grab one, take it. That's our gift to you. The Song of Solomon. This is a often overlooked book, and many of you maybe have never even heard of this particular book. It is ancient Hebrew love poetry. In this book of the Bible that God has inserted the Holy Spirit, it is a collection of love songs that talk about attraction and pursuit and marriage and sexual intimacy. And so we've been kind of framing it in this series with the title Love Songs. So if you are like me and you are a child of the 80s, you might remember having a cassette tape that you were working on, just making the perfect basically mixtape that you could give to your girlfriend. It had all the songs that you wanted, you know, you couldn't articulate it, but like, just listen to this, baby, this is how I feel. And that is what we have, in a sense, in the Song of Solomon. We have a collection of love songs, a collection of love songs. So the first week we looked at the love song that talked about the art of attraction. We looked at what it means to build the right qualities, the character and the virtue. And we used this phrase, we talked about what does it look like to become the one that the one you are looking for is actually looking for. Meaning, looking much for who is the one, where are they? How do I become the one? How do I attract the type of person I'm actually looking for? And so we looked at some of the qualities that make us attractive in our character and in our virtue. And we talked about what does it look like to be attractive before marriage and then in marriage. And then last week we talked about the art of pursuit, what it looks like for a man to pursue a woman in dating, engagement, and marriage, and how we as men pursue our wives, romance them, love them, into marriage itself as well. And so next week, we are going to look at the very important topic of how do we resolve conflicts in our relationships. If you've been married longer than the honeymoon, you may have run into a conflict. In fact, if you have a roommate, you may have run into a conflict. If you are in a family, you may have run into a conflict. If you are not in a locked room by yourself, you may have run into a conflict with someone else. And so, be sure to make it next week as we talk about conflict. Now, this week we're going to talk about sexual intimacy, all right? And this is going to be a PG message, and I really need to hurry. Because last week, the kids came back in from Sunday school when I was wrapping up and was just getting to the important stuff. And so we'll try and move through as quick as we can. Now, what's interesting is as I say this, immediately some of you might be like, ooh, sex, like that's kind of inappropriate. We're in a church setting. I don't know if you should even use that word. And I just want to encourage us that purity is not prudishness. Purity is not prudishness. If the culture is talking about this, if the culture is presenting this at every possible time, it's really important that we go to the Word of God and see how He has designed this important aspect of who we are. So it's interesting, some statistics. By the time a kid graduates high school, they will have seen 14,000 depictions and references to sex on TV. This is before smartphones and TikTok. I don't even know what it would be now. So if you're a parent and you're like, I don't know about like, you know, having the talk with my kids or how I should feel about this, I would just say you're probably already behind the ball. They're probably already have been exposed to things, and it's important to have these sorts of conversations. It was interesting, all the girls that went to Planned Parenthood were interviewed about the giving an abortion, and only 5% had ever had a real conversation with their parents about sex. This is a really needed topic. So if it's uncomfortable to some of you, I would say embrace the discomfort. Teaching about biblical sexuality is incredibly important. And I've gone back and forth this week, but I've come to the conclusion, because if we don't talk about it, somebody else will. And so it's really important that the church not stay silent. So we want to be proactive, not merely reactive. What are some views on sexuality in our culture? The first is the hedonistic view. Everything is about sex. It's the driving goal, it's the aim in all culture and decisions, it's the heartbeat, it's the obsession, it's the ultimate goal and pleasure. Sex is the essential god of the hedonistic view. Another view is the contemporary view that sex is simply a biological function. If I'm hungry, I eat. If I'm feeling turned on, I have sex. What's the big deal? It's just a part of being a person. And this view seems, on the surface, to be accurate, but what we see is that it's actually a very low view of sex, a very low view of sex. There's a rapper named Lecrae, and he went to a conference about, a Christian conference that was speaking about sex, and he said, I always thought Christians had this really low view of, and he went to this conference and he realized, no, actually, the Christian view of sex in the body is actually very, very high, very dignified, very honorable. And so that leads us to a view that many of you may have about sex, and that's the religious view, which is sex is just kind of dirty and kind of weird, and so let's not really talk about it. It's not appropriate. It's not spiritual. It's not something for church. so save it for the one you love. That seems kind of disconnected. And so then some, perhaps even parents here, have adopted the view, the avoidance view. Look, it's a part of life, they'll figure it out, but I don't want to talk about it at all. So, many of you might be familiar with this breakdown. I find it really helpful. When it comes to the idea of sexuality, there really are three ways of looking at it. God, it's our obsession. Gross, we try to avoid it. Or a gift, something that God has given us. So are we obsessed with it? Are we repressing it? Or do we treasure it as a gift from God? Sex is something to be guarded and enjoyed and celebrated. And so I want you to see unabashedly the high view that the scriptures and that the God who created sex has of marital intimacy. So first off, we're going to start off, for those of you who are joining us and are new to the series, the Song of Solomon is a collection of love songs that have been put together. We talked about attraction, we talked about dating. Now we are coming to the wedding day, and we are just going to basically set up the wedding day, and then boom, they skip right to the honeymoon, and we get a front row view. Yes, this is in the Bible, all right? And so pray for me as we go through this, all right? So first, we're going to start with the wedding procession, all right? I'm reading out of the ESV translation. If you have an NIV, that's fairly similar. If you have an app where you can change the translations, you might be helped by just selecting ESV so you can follow it word for word. So we're going to pick it up. Remember, this is not an argument. This is not the Book of Romans. It's poetry. And so the way it flows in a way, and we want to follow the flow of the poetry. So it starts with the woman speaking on her wedding day. It has come to this. We follow this couple's romance and their dating, and now it has come to their wedding day. So we're picking it up in chapter 3 of the Song of Solomon, chapter 3. And we're going to start at verse 6, where we left off last week. And so the woman speaks and says, "What is that coming up from the wilderness like columns of smoke, perfumed with myrrh and frankincense, with all the fragrant powders of a merchant? Behold, it is the litter of Solomon." It is the litter of Solomon. And so what this woman is seeing can be kind of lost on us a little bit. What is this coming from the wilderness like columns of smoke? Evidently, it is the man who's like Solomon, like he's very kingly and royal. He's coming to take his bride. In the ancient time, a wedding ceremony would really work in three different ways, essentially. There would be the celebration where the husband comes. He's built a home, actually, for his new wife. He'd build the home, and then he would just show up randomly with his whole entourage, and they would have a bit of a celebration. Then they would actually go in another room and consummate their relationship. Then they would come back out, and they would have essentially what we would call a reception. They would have a party afterwards, right? And so we're going to see each and every one of those in this love poem, all right? So what she says is, what's this coming through the wilderness like columns of smoke? She's seen her lover, her betrothed, her soon-to-be husband, and he's coming with his entourage through the desert, and there's so many of them that they're actually kicking up the smoke. And so my dad was a Special Forces Green Beret, and he served in Desert Storm and Desert Eagle, and there would be lots of tanks driving through the desert. And you could see them from a mile away because a tank is kicking up all sorts of dust, essentially. And that's the image, that's the picture that this bride-to-be is. She's so excited that she's seen her love, her soon-to-be husband, coming to get her, to celebrate the wedding. And it's interesting, there's one other thing going on here that's important to note, and that is that she's taking this picture of the husband approaching and with this column of smoke. And if you're sort of a Bible nerd and you're familiar with the stories, you might remember that in the story of the Exodus, God's people are in slavery in Egypt, and God shows up and liberates them and leads them to the promised land. And the way that he leads his people, as it says, it's a column of smoke. And so she's saying, as I see my husband approaching and we're about to get married, I feel that same love and protection and guidance and care and covenantal commitment and friendship as I do with God, as I see my soon-to-be husband coming towards me with his entourage. And it's interesting because I want you to see that as we begin this, like, God cares about you. He cares about your romance. He cares about your sex life. He didn't just create these incredible gifts called sex and sexuality and like a grenade, just, okay, here you go, figure it out, careful with the pin, you know, something might happen. He gave us a book. He showed us the way. He explained how to use these great gifts that he's given us. And it's interesting because there's plenty of statistics that show that God's way actually leads to human happiness. The National Health and Social Life Council, they did an extensive survey of American sex lives, and there were four major revelations that came from this nationwide survey. The first is that they found that sexually active singles have the most sexual problems and get the least joy and pleasure out of sexual relationships out of any demographic. And it's interesting because if you watch any movie or TV show, it would be the exact opposite. What's really hot? What's really attractive? Two people that don't know each other and just hook up, as opposed to a man and a woman who have been married for 30, 40, 50 years and know each other very, very well. Next, in this survey, said that men with the most liberal attitudes towards sex are 75% more likely to fail to satisfy their sexual partners. Evidently, just having all sorts of none of this matters and I can do what I want and hook up with who I want doesn't actually lead to long-term satisfaction. Number three in this survey, married couples by far report the most sexually satisfaction out of any demographic survey in the country. Meaning, if you want to figure out what it means to do this sex thing, this gift that God's given right and well, evidently it has something to do with marriage. Statistically, it shows that. Here's the other interesting thing. Point number four, the most sexually satisfied married couples with the highest level of sexual satisfaction, according to this nationwide survey, were married between the years of 50 and 59 years old. Interesting. It would appear that God's plan of creating male and female, having them bind together in a marriage covenant for a lifetime, in which they enjoy increasing sexual intimacy as the bond that keeps them together and joyful, it would seem like, statistically, it's saying, hey, that actually creates the most human happiness. And so, marriage should be held in honor. It shouldn't be some silly thing that people do as kind of an addendum or an add-on. It is the crescendo, the commitment, the symbol of what this couple is going to give themselves to for the rest of their lives. So it goes on, the woman says, around it, oh yeah, let me explain this real quick because some of you, so verse 7 says, behold, it is the litter of Solomon. Now, some of you might hear, the litter of Solomon? Right? We live in Seattle, we're like, what? They're just dumping garbage everywhere? They're running through the desert, just like dropping garbage everywhere. Well, the litter, some of you might be familiar with this. The litter is essentially sort of a carriage or a carrying device that, you know, two people would hold and the king would be in the middle, maybe sitting on cushions or in something in particular. So that's what they are holding. And evidently around him are 60 mighty men, some of the mighty men of Israel. Now, again, what's being commented on here is that David, King David, Solomon's dad, he had 30 mighty men. These were like his elite warriors. And what she's saying is, here comes this guy who's like, he's got this entourage, his friends who are with him. And it's like they're like double the mighty men, right? This guy is, he's known, he's loved, he's got friends. And what does the woman feel? She feels protected, she feels cared for. Look at this, verse 8. All of them wearing swords and experts in war, each with his sword at his thigh, against terror by night. The thing that I have learned being the husband of a wonderful woman and the dad of two little girls is that for a woman, one of the most terrifying things is to be alone at night. And let me frame it like this. What would you say, ladies, is one of the scariest things you can run into in a dark alley in the middle of the night? A man. A man with no moral restraint who wants to do what he wants. And what she is saying is, I find joy because here comes my future husband and his friends. And she feels, hey, this is not an exploit of strength that he is going to use against me, but I am protected and cared for and loved by him. A real man protects his future bride even from himself. Because genuine love wants the best for the other, not just to take, but to give. To see the woman of his affections flourish and prosper. And so this just makes sense. Think about this, guys. For the guys that maybe don't understand, why is a woman, why is this deep need in her heart to be protected, to be cared for? Think of it this way. You work really hard and you make a lot of money. Do you not want to take that money and give it to a financial advisor who's going to invest it well for you, who's going to turn a profit long term, who is honorable and trustworthy, who you can give those things that are most precious to you, that's similar to your life, and vitally, and give that to that financial advisor in a way that he's going to multiply and bless and is trustworthy? If you understand that dynamic, you might be able to understand why the deep heart need of a woman is to feel loved and cared for and protected. She has to take her life and walk out on the icy surface of your character. Is it going to hold? Are you going to keep your word? Are you going to stay faithful to your vows? Are you going to love your kids? Are you going to stay with her for a lifetime? Trust takes a long time to build and is very quickly broken. And so the most important thing you can do in a relationship is to be paying into the trust bank. In fact, when you think about it, what's the difference for those of you who are married? What's the difference between the person you married and the person you're sitting next to on the bus? Trust, experience, lifetime together. Trust is the most important thing. It's what defines a relationship. It's the foundation by which you build them. Now look at how he is enabling her to trust him. She says, King Solomon made himself a carriage. She's calling her man, he's like a king. He made himself a carriage from the wood of Lebanon. This is the best. This is the choice wood. This is the good stuff. He made its posts of silver, its back of gold, its seats of purple. This is the metals of wealth, showing that, man, he has made some good business decisions. He's figured out his life. He's got a job. He's working hard. She can trust him with her life as they look towards marriage. And then it says that the seat is a purple. That's the color of loyalty. This is a very difficult color in the ancient times to have. Nowadays, you can just go get purple anything. Back then, you had to get a certain shell that had this purple dye in it that was very difficult even to find. So purple was beautiful, was fancy, was special. And he's basically saying, nothing is too good for you. And it goes on, it says, its interior was inlaid with love by the daughters of Jerusalem. This is the equivalent of many of you have been to or had perhaps at your wedding, a fancy car or a limousine that took you to your honeymoon. That is what's happening here. Every detail is quality. And he's thought of everything. He is romancing her. He is anticipating her needs. He isn't cutting any corners. He isn't phoning it in. He isn't making any excuses. This is a Pinterest-perfect wedding ceremony. Every single detail. And he cares about the details. Gentlemen, care about the details. You're looking not just for a good time and a good legacy. You're not looking for just a beautiful ceremony, but a beautiful marriage. You're looking not just for a great wedding, but you're looking for a trustworthy spouse that you can share a lifetime with. I remember when me and my wife, Crystal, were engaged, I knew how important it was, speaking about every little detail. The big detail for her was, you need to talk with my parents. You need to ask my dad. And I'm like, okay, yeah, right. I've seen that in movies and stuff. Okay, I'll do that. But I wasn't quite sure how it worked. So I was like, okay, so I guess I've got to basically sit down and share all my finances and my life plan and where I'm going. And so I wore a suit. I borrowed a tie. I also borrowed a friend's really fancy briefcase. And I went over and I sat down with her parents and they were just laughing the whole time. They were being so kind. And I opened my briefcase, and I gave them, I said, here's my life plan, here are my financials, here are my investments, these are my intentions with your daughter. And they laughed and thought the whole thing was hilarious, but I assume, because I have two little girls, I assume that they were also blessed.
Yeah.
Love to care the details. Love anticipates what's ahead. And many of you guys were like, look, that doesn't really matter as long as the way I feel. And great, I'm glad you feel that way, but does your love move forward into a spreadsheet? Does your love think about the finances? Does your love think about what's going to happen next? Does your love think after the honeymoon? So this guy's got every I dotted, every T crossed. And verse 11, she says, the woman says to her friends, go out, O daughters of Zion. That's a term basically for the young ladies in her community. She says, look upon King Solomon. Look upon my husband, my groom-to-be, with the crown with which his mother crowned him on the day of his wedding, on the day of the gladness of his heart. He's been patient. He's romanced me. He's loved me. We've planned a life together. Look at him in his glory. He's coming to get his bride. This is a beautiful picture. Any romance, any marriage is ultimately a picture of the way that God feels about his people. Did you realize God had all of creation? Oh, I've got, you know, apple trees and whales, and you could have compared the way he feels about us to anything, but do you know what he chose? A wedding. Romantic love. He said, that's the way that I feel for my people. No matter what happens, and no matter what they do, and no matter what they think and feel, and no matter where they run, and no matter what they've said, I will love them, I will pursue them, I will care for them. And so any good wedding where a husband has laid down his life to provide for his bride is a picture of the way that God loves his people. And so I just want to encourage you, especially young men, as you are thinking about what it might mean to get married, look at the example we have in this man in the Song of Solomon. He has provided for his bride-to-be. He considered every detail. And I'm often sometimes shocked when I talk with young people, and I get it, you've never been married before. So, but there's a tendency to say this person's beautiful, and we enjoyed having fun together, so let's get married. Okay, let's consider every detail. Do you want kids? When will you have kids? How will you provide for the kids? Where will you live, and what happens next? You want to cover the bases, guys. You want to make sure that you have each and every detail figured out. So, you cannot build a marriage on sexual attraction. You have to build it on character, and you have to build it on shared values. Now, they are married, and guess what? We don't get a whole lot on the ceremony. We don't get a whole lot of, marriage is what brings us together today. We skip right from the ceremony to the honeymoon. We just run right through the reception. I know some of you got married, and it was kind of like that. It was like, hey, I'm married, bye. Right? We're done. We're heading off to the honeymoon. And so that's where we go. So this is in the Bible. I'm reading the Bible. Okay? I'm going to read the Bible and explain it. We're going into the honeymoon suite for a couple's first night, a marital intimacy together. And we see the man, we talked about the man initiating. Here we go. Chapter 4, verse 1. Behold, you are beautiful, my love. Behold, you are beautiful. So, first thing, after all the chaos and excitement and the details of the wedding, they finally get a moment to themselves, a moment alone. I remember when me and my wife, after we had gotten married, I had gotten a limousine. It was actually my first time ever in a limousine, so that felt pretty cool in and of itself. And as we were leaving, we're waving goodbye to everyone. I mean, there were so many details and everything we had to figure out. I'm getting into the limousine. My wife's already in there. I'm getting in this flash coming out the door. I'm like, what was that? And the photographer wanted to get like a beautiful picture of us like both going into the, but the actual picture is crystal, just glorious in her wedding dress all spread out. She's laughing and she looks like a Hollywood movie star. And then it's like my butt sticking out. Unfortunately, Photoshop was just coming out at that time. I'm like, let's just go ahead and erase that. It's a gorgeous picture of Crystal, but so we're driving to our honeymoon suite, and we're in this limousine, and we have like the most chatty Cathy driver ever, right? Like, we just got married, we got all the things we want to do, and he's like, hey, how's it going, guys? What's up? What's your favorite baseball team? I'm like, isn't there a way to close the window here? We've got things to do. So he's finally, it's that moment in the honeymoon suite where all of the details have been finished. All of the, you know, it almost felt like I had been in lots of like plays and stuff. And I was talking, it almost felt like that, but now we're done and we're married. Whoa, this is awesome. Let's do this. So, behold, you are beautiful, my love, beautiful. So he's taking a moment and he's just drinking in her beauty. And I just say the very first thing. This is a very, very, specific person, but for those of you who are on the cusp of getting married, and especially if you're a Christian, you've been trying to honor God with your sexuality, and you've been trying to withhold and wait for the honeymoon, I just want to encourage you in one thing. If you've waited this long, like, take it slow. All right? I know a lot of people are just like, ah, I'm here! Ah! Notice the way he approaches this. There is praise. Excuse me. There's praise, there's affection, there's kindness, there's sweetness, there's love. He goes on. Your eyes are doves behind your veil. This, most commentators would say, is probably reflecting large eyelashes, like dove wings. There's a beauty and a grace there. Notice that he starts, John was important, he starts with her eyes. Doesn't start lower. We're actually going to see he's going to work down her body, but he starts with eyes. Eyes, as Pastor Ken likes to say, are the windows to the soul. When you look deeply into somebody's eyes, you do connect with them in a unique way, and that's where he starts, with her eyes, behind her veil. He says, your hair is like a flock of goats leaping down the slopes of Gilead. You have goat hair. might not be the best thing to say to your wife on your wedding night. Obviously, by the way, one of the things you might have noticed, too, is that here at the church, for those of you who are new, we do like to use slides for things, right? But since we're on the honeymoon, we felt, let's just go with the text and leave the slides off for now. So you're going to have to visualize some of these things, especially because it's ancient language. But your hair is like a flock of goats leaping down the slopes of Gilead. You get kind of what he's saying. There's a waviness, there's a flow, there's a beauty to it. And in particular, in ancient cultures, a woman's head would always be veiled. And so, even now, hair is a very sensual thing, or at least can be. And so what he's saying is, like, you can imagine at this point he's taking off her hair, or if her hair was in a veil and it's done up, you know, with all those pins in it and everything, her husband is taking her hair and it's waving down her neck and her shoulders. And we know that she's liking this because we can see that she starts to smile, right? And so if you're a dentist or you know a dentist, this is their life verse, okay? Verse 2, your teeth are like a flock of shorn goats, right? Meaning they're white, they're beautiful. She's smiling because this moment of intimacy with her husband is not a moment of shame, but a moment of glory, a moment of delight. He says they are like they've come up from the washing, right? It just watched, she's got good breath, right? They're practicing with her. All of which bear their twins, and not one of them as lost as young, right? She's not missing a single tooth, right? They're all there where they should be, praise the Lord. And so, as he's undying her mouth, he seems to move in for a kiss. He says, your lips are like scarlet thread, and your mouth is lovely. He is admiring her unique feminine lips, and he's enjoying himself. And evidently, she is continuing to smile, even blush at this point, as her husband is reaching for her in their honeymoon suite. He says, your cheeks are like halves of pomegranate behind your veil. She's blushing, sees the color starting to emerge in her cheeks. He continues to move down her body. And at this point, she might already be wearing nothing at all, but a necklace. He says in verse 4, your neck is like the Tower of David, built in rows of stone. On it, thousands of shields of avoidance. Now, this is very odd. Most people are like, you're what? Your neck is like a tower? That's not my go-to. What is he talking about here? What? And when you think about the imagery, it actually makes a whole lot of sense and jumps out. He's saying, first off, it's her posture, that she seems to be fully, her head is not downcast. She is enjoying herself. She's standing up straight. She has strength and dignity. She has this long, beautiful, swan-like neck. And there is a difference, ladies, I'll just say this, and there's a big difference in a man desiring you and a man esteeming you, and a man respecting you, not just admiring you. Notice he is saying that your neck is like the Tower of David. There's a strength and a dignity to you. Proverbs 31 talks about the ideal woman, and it says she is clothed with dignity. Clothed with dignity. And so you, ladies, want a guy that is going to value your heart and mind. He's going to see the dignity that you have. And it's interesting because there are so many cultural scripts right now which have women behaving in such undignified and sad and heartbreaking ways. There's a popular TV show called She-Hulk. And in it, the main character, the She-Hulk, is a woman who is transformed and has superpowers. And throughout the show, she's basically trying to get in relationships with various guys. And at one point, she meets a guy on Tinder who's attracted to her in her She-Hulk form. He's a, you know, she's a big green woman, sort of the ideal woman. And so they go to bed together. And the show is supposed to be lighthearted and kind of comedy. What happens is in the morning, she's up making him breakfast, and he comes out, and she's no longer in her She-Hulk form. And he says, and just takes off. And usually she breaks the third wall and kind of makes snarky jokes. And just for a second, she just kind of looks at the camera. And you just see all of the angst and the pain of the cultural script that we give women. You're not a man. You should be valued. You have dignity. You don't have to throw yourself or sacrifice yourself for the esteem of a man. First off, God created you, so you have inherent value, dignity, and worth. Second off, there are men that will care for you and love you for who you are. That's the type of guy that you want to look for. Don't buy the cultural scripts. It might seem like a lot of fun, but when you're jumping in and out of bed, you find that your heart, it's so fascinating. There was an interesting article that was talking about a lot of young women right now, especially in Silicon Valley, and their sex life and dating. One of the women reported in the article was she was saying, I just feel so miserable because when I give myself to one of these guys, I feel like I'm falling in love with them, but then I know that that's wrong. God created you to fall in love, to give yourself to someone for a lifetime together. What our culture is doing is fundamentally trying to cut against the grain of human nature. The physical act of giving yourself to another in lovemaking is bonding. It's not for evaluation, it's not for dating, it's for bonding, it's for lifelong commitment. When we take that great gift that God has given and we use it in a flippant way, we are doing violence to our souls. You have more dignity. You have more worth and you have more value than that. Do not buy the cultural scripts. Now he continues down and he was from the military imagery of her eyes and her neck down her body to her breasts. In verse 5 he says, your two breasts are like two fawns, twins of a gazelle that gaze among the lilies. Notice the approach. It is gentle and it is slow. Guys, I just want to encourage you. We've said this before. Men are microwaves, women are crock pots. However much you're into it, ratchet it back like 40 times, all right? You'll do yourself a great service. Notice the words that he uses, love, attention, self-esteem, commitment, these are intertwined with a woman's sexuality and the way that she is turned on. When she feels emotionally loved, she is open to being physically loved. And it's interesting to me because, I'm gonna go for it. There is a proliferation of pornography. Most young men are exposed to porn at age 9. And in my day, pornography was like a dirty magazine that your friend had under his bed. Now it's just on your phone and everywhere. And so, pornography, especially when you're exposed as a young man, and nobody, I'm saying this out of love for your kids, especially those of you who have teenage sons, to have these conversations and have them continuously. The desires that you have are good. They need to be channeled. They need to be channeled into loving a wife. They need to be channeled into growing up. The desires you have are the strongest, as a young man, these are the strongest desires you will ever have in your life. And so master them, give them to God because he gave them to you. And what happens is when that doesn't, the male desire, the male aggression, the testosterone gets mangled and misused in hormones. So there was a report that said that in the proliferation of hookup culture, 38% of women report being choked and unable to breathe during a casual hookup. That is not manly. That is not loving a woman. That is abusing a woman. That is taking advantage of a woman. Men, you are to be gentle. You are to love notice that he is constantly praising her and drawing her out and wooing her. This takes self-control. This takes patience. This takes the ability to care more about her than yourself and to allow her to be able to open up in her time. Is she comfortable? Is she enjoying this? Is this pleasing to her and not just some twisted fantasy that I've had before? What does it mean to be a man? It is to love your wife, not to simply dominate and use her. So go slow. Love. 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 With patience and care and kindness. Verse 6, until the day breathes and the shadows flee, I will go to the mountain of myrrh and to the hill of frankincense. This is actually where we had to end last time as the kids came in from Sunday school. This is an allusion to her breasts. And he's basically saying, I'm going to make love to you all night long. So if you have a Bible and you're flipping to the back, you're like, I've got to get to the maps. Where's the hill of frankincense? I'm not seeing that anywhere. You're not going to find it. The Bible has this unashamed view of sex. Proverbs 5 says to a young man who's getting married, rejoice in the wife of your youth. May her breasts satisfy you at all times. May you ever be intoxicated by her love. I'm not sure if you see that one on coffee cups, but maybe we should. 1 Corinthians 7 says that it is our privilege, duty, and responsibility to give ourselves to our spouse regularly. For joy, for procreation, for protection. There are many, many, many reasons, but this is a great gift of God. And so this woman, evidently at this point, is standing naked before her husband with all of her insecurities, all of her flaws. There's nothing more vulnerable than to be physically naked in front of somebody else. And he has this precious moment. Gentlemen, many of you have experienced this or will on your wedding night, where you have this unique opportunity. Your wife is in front of you, and in that moment, you can either speak life or you can destroy it. And what you say, you can either honor or shame. And verse 7, beautiful example set. He says, you are altogether beautiful, my love. There is no flaw in you. Every woman wants to feel like her husband sees her as absolutely beautiful. And so, gentlemen, I want to encourage you to cultivate the attitude of one woman. If your wife has dark curly hair, then that's what you're into. Mm-hmm. She has light blonde hair, then that's what you're into. But what about all the other women? What about all the pictures? What about all this stuff? Cultivate means that you work hard to get your heart to recognize that she is the gift that God has given you. You're not going to delight another woman if you're hiding on your phone or under your bed or in your mind. You're going to delight in her. You're going to baptize your imagination. You're going to think of her and have eyes for her. You are going to love her. Imagine, for those of you who are struggling with pornography, imagine if all that energy and that time that you wasted and that you lied and that you felt ashamed, imagine if you took all of that and you wrote your wife love letters and you thought about her and you cultivated an ability to be a one-woman man and think of her. He goes on, come with me from Lebanon and Harmon, from the dens of lions, from the mountains of leopards. You have captivated my heart, my sister, my bride. You have captivated my heart with one glance of your eyes, with one jewel of your necklace. He's saying, let's get out of here. Let's get away. Let's just have it be me and you forever. Let's keep that honeymoon going for as long as we possibly can. I love this language. You've captivated my heart. All the desires I had are being met in you. You've stolen my breath. He says, with one glance of your eyes. Many of you married men know when your wife gives you that look. You're like, all right, it's time to go. It's time to go. Great message. Good church service. We're leaving, right? And that's what is happening with this guy. He's like, man, she's captivated my heart. I'm enraptured by her. And he says, my sister, my bride. Don't think of being incestuous. This is endearment. This is intimacy. This is his best friend. This is the person that he knows him the most. She's arrested him. She's captivated him. And it's interesting because this is the way it should be. This is 100% the way it should be. The Bible makes no qualms. It has no. It's not blushing. It's just forthright on sexual intimacy. And it's heartbreaking to me that our culture, and in particular marketing, has basically taken this and like, hey, we can
some stuff with this. We don't have to honor the marriage bed. We can sell our cologne or our beer or our cards. You walk through a mall and you see like a 50-foot picture of a woman half naked down on her knees with this alluring look on her face. And you sort of look around and there's a bunch of old men and little kids. You're like, that's not a look for me. I don't know you and I don't know any. Like, you, that's good. Ladies, you should do that and look at that with your husband, but not in the middle of the mall in front of everyone. So to make a distinction isn't to devalue, rather it is to honor. The church has a very high view of sex. Every married couple, go have lots of sex this week. The pastor told me, right? But to put that out in the middle of a public area because you're trying to sell something is wicked. It's wicked. It's not for everyone. It's special. It's significant. It's for someone who's going to give their life and their finances and their commitment to you. And then go and have a ton of fun. Verse 10, how beautiful is your love, my sister, my bride. How much better is your love than wine and the fragrance of your oils than spice. It's better than to get married and to love a godly woman is better than the best wines. It's to be with her, to smell her is better than the best perfumes. Go verse 11, your lips drip nectar, my bride. Your lips drip nectar. This is clearly their... Actually, this isn't a French kiss, since it's thousands of years before France even existed. So this is a Hebrew kiss. This is the way God's people enjoy one another. He's close enough to kiss her and to smell her. And he's saying the greatest scents in the world don't compare to you. And notice he says, honey and milk are under your tongue. The fragrance of your garments is like the fragrance of Lebanon. That's a beautiful forest, the freshness of that smell. But I love this honey and milk. Because again, if you're a bit of a Bible nerd, you might remember that when God's people were liberated from slavery, they were promised the promised land, which was a land flowing with milk and honey. And he's saying, the promised land is being with you, is enjoying marital intimacy. And he says, it's like milk and honey. Milk is nourishment and honey is delight. And in both milk and honey, it has to die to produce these things. He's like, it is just delight in nourishment and life. And I just drink it up. And notice, this is kind of a dated reference, but I'll go for it. Notice he's not like John Mayer in a famous song saying, your body is a wonderland. Your body is an amusement park that I enjoy. He's saying, your body is life-giving. Your body is life-giving. Here's the incredible thing. God designed sex for pleasure. And in Proverbs 5, it says, may her breasts satisfy you, fill you with delight. But also, he had designed sex so that there could be more people and life could go on. Sex is the very act of creating life itself. And by it, we share in the attributes of God who spoke life into being and in married love, you're actually creating life. And so he goes on in verse 12, a garden locked is my sister, my bride, a spring locked, a fountain sealed. This is the allusion to her virginity. This is the divine stamp of God saying, hands off until you promise to give this woman your whole life. She is protected. She's guarded. And so he has now given himself to her, and she is now giving herself to him. And so verse 13, 14, and 15 are this beautiful language of a garden in which they delight in one another. Gentlemen, I'm not encouraged. Like, there are so many churches and so many times where you hear this really negative view of masculinity and the male desire for sex. Like, there's a reason God gave you that, and it's good. I'm encouraging you to channel it in the way that's most fulfilling. Delight in the wife of your youth. May her breasts satisfy you always. Go ahead and take Proverbs 5 and write it down. That's your memory. And so how does she respond? He has given himself to her financially, and he's given commitment, and he's given himself emotionally. He loved her, he's wooed her, and now there are these physical delights that they're enjoying together. We hear from the bride on her wedding night. She speaks here at the end. She says, awake, O north wind, and come, O south wind. Blow upon my garden, and let its spices flow. Let my beloved come to his garden, and eat its choicest. is now giving herself to him. Throughout the last couple of weeks, we've seen this refrain where it says, do not awaken love until it's time. And now, on their honeymoon night, it is time. She invites him to enjoy her choice fruits, an allusion to sexual intimacy. And men, I would just encourage you that this is earned, not deserved. Notice the way that he has romanced her, he has loved her, he's been patient with her. This is a privilege of right. You want that kind of response, then you have to do that kind of lead up. So do the dishes, take out the trash, meet her needs, sit and talk with her, buy her some flowers, tell her how much she means to you. Before you try to show her with elements of your body, show her with your mind and your words. And then we end with verses, the first part of chapter 5. He says, I came to, so evidently, he now, like a movie, the camera now cuts away from the wedding night. He has loved her, she has opened up to him, they're enjoying this gift of sexual intimacy in marriage. And so the camera pans away and we pick it up, I guess, in the morning, maybe at breakfast or something, and we hear from the gentleman after his first night with his bride. He says, I came to my garden, my sister, my bride, I gathered my spice, I ate my comb with my honey, and I drank my wine with milk. Notice that he doesn't say, I hit that, I got you some. He doesn't dehumanize her, he praises her. He compares her to honey and the nourishment in the life. Even after the fact, he's still praising her. Gentlemen, your pursuit of your wife is ongoing. It doesn't finish after a night of passion. It builds. It builds and builds. Delight in your wife. In what ways is your wife nourishing to you? What way does she provide for you? Does she help you? Does she care for the family and sustain the home? How does she nourish you? And in what ways is she a delight to you? We just enjoy being around here, hearing her laugh, telling jokes with her, spending time with her. Tell her those things. Write them down. Care for her by telling her how much you appreciate her. And the last thing, in the ESV it says others, which is trying to delineate. This is a whole different group of people. So if you remember in the beginning, I said there's ceremony, the consummation, and then the celebration. In ancient times, the consummation was so important to the marriage union that they would actually have the vows exchanged. The couple would then go into another room, off the main room, like through that door or something, and then come back after they had done the deed, and everyone would celebrate and cheer for them, right? And so what it says here is essentially that. Eat, friends, drink, and be drunk with love. That's beautiful. That's satisfying. That's why God gave us this gift. That's how to enjoy it. That is something that we as a community will delight in. The marriage bed should be held in honor, meaning we should encourage and delight in married people coming together regularly and being intimate, romantic with one another. I would just encourage you, especially if you're new with us or you're watching online, never, never, never underestimate the importance of the community around you to the health and vitality of your marriage. I have seen really bad marriages, really rough marriages, succeed and do well because they were in a good community.
Yes, that's true.
Your community will deeply impact the health and vitality of your marriage. And so I just want to encourage you to be in a community that will say, enjoy, drink deeply, and be drunk in love. That has a high view of sexuality and a high view of marriage. And what I want to encourage you is that that evil does not create anything. It can only distort what God made there. So if you're leaving, what's the big idea of this? God made sex. He intended it as a gift for us. The best way to steward it is in the confines of marriage. And how then do we go about all this? We exist in a community that believes that and will encourage us to live in light of it. And why? Because that's the way ultimately God loved us. He loved us as a lover who came from heaven to earth. He went to the cross. He died in our place for our sins. That is what love looks like. And that's the kind of community we want to foster, one that holds marriage in honor and loves like Jesus did. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So I'm going to go ahead and invite our worship team up, and I will pray for us that this message would bear fruit in many ways that God intended it to. So Heavenly Father, I thank you for those who are here, who are able to hear this message, and those who joined us online. Lord, I know for some this might have been awkward or some surprising that the Bible even says these things. But God, I thank you, Lord, that you have not left us without a plan, without a guide through word. And Lord, I pray that this community would be one that would love you and would encourage godly marriages, godly intimacy, that we would celebrate and train and teach these things. And so, Lord, as we preach on this and as we think about and meditate about these things, Lord, I pray that it would bear fruit in the marriages in this room and the marriages that will be formed by the singles who are in this room. Lord, be in the midst of us. Have your will and your way with us, Lord. May we be your people, marked by a love for you, by an obedience to your word. We pray all this in the strong name of Jesus. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen.
Exalted. We are going to exalt him now through partaking in communion. So if you're a believer, feel free to grab the elements on the table in the back. If you're not, feel free just to watch. But what we do now is we remember, in the same way we were talking about the marriage covenant, we remember the covenant that the Lord Jesus made with us, and how he chose for us to both remember and experience him through the elements that he gave us. So the scripture says this: "For I have received from the Lord Jesus, what I also deliver to you." So this is the tradition that God's people have been doing since the time of Jesus. That the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was to be betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us remember his body broken for us as he was lifted up on the cross to die for us. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant." There's that word, the promise. "The new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat the bread and you drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Let us claim his death in our place for our sins. Amen.
Thank you for his forgiveness and his grace. If you're with us, we do a pop-up. talk right afterwards. You're welcome to grab some food. If you have food, go ahead and take those down to the left as our fellowship hall. Let me pray for us, and I'll dismiss. So Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that we have seen the light of salvation and revelation in Jesus Christ, that our sins are forgiven, that we're loved, we're given hope and a future, and a way of doing relationships and marriage. And Lord, we just thank you for all of your gifts to us. Help us to be good stewards of them. Lord, as we go off into our week, God, be with us. Help us to honor you. Lord, thank you for this food. We pray a blessing over it as we enjoy time together. And people bring dishes. Lord, we thank you for all those who work hard to make such wonderful food for us to enjoy. We pray you would bless this dinner and our time together and bless those who need to head out. We thank you, Lord. We pray all this in Jesus' name. All God's people say,
amen. Amen.